posters we're going to see afterwards in the continuation of the session. So, Dr. Leif.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here again. As Robert said, I see a lot of familiar faces, but also some new faces. Always nice to be in Vienna. So I will talk about monitoring of embankment dams and show some experiences from work we've done in Sweden. This work has been done together with colleagues who are working in a small company, Hydro Research, Pontus Sjödahl, who is a former PhD student of mine, and some new ones on. We've been working. The bulk of this work was really done many years ago, and we have some ongoing monitoring that we hope to be able to boost up and be more active on this, but it's a matter of funding. The funding for this work was provided by dam owners and dam-affiliated group in the airport. So I just want to give an overview of some experiences from the start until now and say a few words about design of embankment dams, what it means for ERT, mention about how we did installations, data processing, and chosen examples from that one. So this is the first dam that we made measurements on, and we basically went there a number of times and did measurements. We started out putting out pin electrodes like this that we left in place between measurements, and we very soon found out that this was a bad thing, bad way to do it, because they came loose and we got very bad contact. So we soon concluded that if we instead put a steel plate like this, we would get 10 times higher contact area, and also the soil would keep contact in place all the time. So that's what we've been using since then. We did measurements at the number of time and could see a seasonal variation, which is what we expected. So this was published in the no longer existing European journal, which is now Near Surface Geophysics. But this is the way a typical Swedish embankment dam is designed. We have a core constructed of fine-grained soil. There's a filter with intermediate grain soil to keep it in place, and then support fill, which would be blasted rock or something like that. It's designed to so that water from the reservoir will leak very, very slowly through the core here. But if there is some kind of damage, it would be a much faster leakage, which will affect the temperature regimes and in turn then the resistivity variation. So temperature monitoring is a very powerful tool for detecting leakage, but it's difficult to install temperature sensors all over in an existing dam. These are typical locations where it's practical to install electrodes on many of the Swedish dams, in the crest of the core, at the dam toe, and somewhere on the upstream side. Whereas this could be large blocks of stone, which are almost impossible to get current into. This also means that we have channeling of the current. The core is typically the most conductive part of the dam, where you will get current channeling. The support field is pretty resistive, and the reservoir water is typically more resistive than the core of the dam in Swedish dams. So if you do measurement along the crest, you will get very severe 3D effects, which have been simulated here. So in this case, up to 6 times wrong value. So the results can be used as anomaly indicator, but we should not trust the absolute values. So our concept of this is that we measure resistivity, which is linked to temperature, which is in turn linked to water flow. So it's an indirect way of detecting water flow, where we're using temperature variation as a natural tracer. And we try to use this then for integrity control and monitoring. Non-destructive, non-penetrating is a benefit. But then it is really important also to consider variations in TDS, water level, ground freezing, etc., when you evaluate the results. So this is one of the dams that we've been working with, the first where we did a permanent installation. So you have the turbine, etc., in the central part and the spillway here. Then you have an embankment dam on each side. And this is a top view then. So we have electrodes installed along the crest of both dams, on the upstream side, and also on the downstream side. But this has become pretty dysfunctional after they did some reconstruction works. One reason why we chose this site is that the water level is more or less constant over the year here, which facilitates evaluation. So it was a good place to start. It dams a reservoir of 44 square kilometers, so if this dam would collapse, it would mean wet feet downstream. Some shots from the installation. We use steel plates like this, buried at about a meter's depth. This is along one of the crests, downstream side. This all seemed very good, except that we discovered that afterwards, after many years, it became clear that there is a thermal insulation layer below here which wasn't documented and not known, and that had a severe impact on data quality. So this is the type of electrodes we had in the reservoir here on the upstream side, installed by divers. And this is the first version of the system, based on some standard ABM components of that day, and a standard AD converter with serial interface, some home-built lightning protection, and other interfaces. And it was, at that time, communicating over a telephone modem, so we had to call it every now and then and download data, and this was a constant pain because the telephone line was so bad. Typical temporal variation of temperature in the dam here, so in the winter 0 degrees, in the summer 15 to 20 degrees typically. And this means more or less a factor 2 in resistivity. As you can see here, so the measured resistivity here varies from say 350 ohmmeters in the summer up to 700-800 ohmmeters in the winter, so not too many ions in this water. As I mentioned, thermal insulation layer means trouble for data quality, and we got some really shaky data. So these are the daily values that fluctuate a lot here. We're now looking at a single data point from day to day, from extracting one data point from the pseudosections, and we had to play around a lot with data filtering here and time-based filtering, and came up with some pretty stable results. So the gray here is the raw data, and these are our weekly data that we extracted, which are a lot smoother than. So we did this time-based filtering, extracted weekly averages, and inverted each weekly data set, and then ran statistics on that. So this is the variation, relative variation from all these weekly data sets. And you can see that there's a lot of variation in the top near the surface because of freezing and moisture variation. Normally it should reduce with depth, but here is an anomalous part, and if we look at the temporal variation in a cross-section like here, and look at the cells going from top here, see a lot of variation, but at the lower levels much less variation. This is what we would expect. But at this point here we have large variations, we have a trend with time, and we have an increasing trend of resistivity variation. And this is interpreted as ongoing internal erosion with washout of fine material, because then you remove the most conductive part of the core and of the measurement volume. So we actually, the water content increases, but it's high resistive water, so by removing the fines we get an increase in resistivity trend, as we interpret it here. There's very little reference data to support this, but there was for certain washout of fines noticed. There were anomalous groundwater levels on the downstream side of the core in this part, etc. So there were several indications that said that we have a problem here, and they decided to modify the dam. They did a couple of things. They raised the core of about 1 meter or something like that, and they also put on like a thick support fill on the downstream side of the dams. And this is from when this was these works were made, and we had to reinstall the electrodes, of course. And we had every second electrode was a steel plate, every second a non-polarizable electrode, because we wanted to measure SP also. So we've been measuring SP here, but the results are really difficult to interpret because there's so much metal. I don't know if it was visible here, but yeah, you can see here they've been injecting some stabilizing material in the dam. So part of the dam is like a forest of iron pipes. So really nasty for SP measurements. And yeah, here are some more shots from the installations. So this is the working version of the instrument up there. Also, well, based on the same old ABM standard components, but now with updated receiver control unit, and this is a relay switch switching from left to right, and some with built-in lightning protection. And now this is an internet modem installed. So, and this is a shot from the software that is running there, and you can see which electrodes are active at the moment. So data are sent every night to a server in Lund, and then this is the basic setup of the system. We have a server in Lund, and then can have a number of sites that upload the data automatically, and then there are checksums, etc., to check that it's working and with integrity, and then acknowledgement is sent back. So they know that it has been sent and it doesn't need to be resent. It's been working in a very stable way for over 10 years. So I wanted to show some example results. We measure with different electrode arrays. I will show multiple gradient array here. We measure resistivity in IP, but IP evaluation is not included in the automated processing, and we haven't had time to implement it, unfortunately. So again, also for the later data, we use weekly averages generally. So these weekly averages are inverted with risk to the end, where we use a low pass filtered sliding reference data set, because we have a very large seasonal variation. So if we would use just an average value of everything, we would damp natural variation too much, in our opinion. Then we do statistical evaluation of the weak inversion models and plot some selected parameters. This is a software I wrote many years ago, which is still the one which is being used where you can. So basically it reads the zip write data file from the zip archive from each days, and then does all this automatically. And here's an example then from the left crest, same as before, and here is the relative variation. What we can see now is we have much less variation in the surface, in the near surface parts here, which would suggest that we have a better thermal insulation from the top here. And it's mainly in the ends here where we have joining to the concrete and and there's some sheet piling here in this end, and this is where it connects to natural ground, where we have more variation, and also still around the same area actually, but so that they didn't actually do anything substantial about the that they couldn't read the core there, but they put a lot of support fill on the downstream side. So supposedly it's still leaking, but it's under in a more controlled way, I guess. This is from the this is just showing it as variation coefficient instead, so more or less the same. Here is result from the right crest, and median inverted model through these 6 years here, or 5 years, and then the variation coefficient, and again, much less variation in the shallow parts, but variation here. This is another site further north in Sweden. I'm not allowed to say the name of it. The dam owner is a bit sort of secret. But anyway, here are installations along the dam crest and on the downstream side of the dam. Same concept as you can see, but in this case only steel electrodes. And similar kind of instruments. So also here we see strong temperature variation, zero in the winter, 15, 20 something in the summer. And the resistivity varies here from slightly lower, around 300 to some 600-700 ohmmeters in the reservoir water. So here are results then from the dam crest measurements, and it looks pretty homogeneous in the upper part here. We have some areas of more variation in the lower parts here, and if we continue, here I played around recently. I just had to look at the IP data, so I managed to, I just took two data sets, one from the winter and one from the summer, and did a IP time lapse inversion, and this is something that we should really try to get time to work more with, but here is an area of larger variation in the tranquility, which maybe connects with this. I haven't got the scaling right here, but So just curiosity to see what I could get here. And here is from the downstream line. I should say that the data quality from this side is really very good, much better than from the other side. There are areas with relatively large relative variation in the deeper parts here, which are indicative of this is indicative of variations in flow, water flow. I also played around with this, and this looks honestly not maybe too credible. I don't know what to make out of this, but would there's some IP variation. But it's only two data sets without this sort of time filtering and so on, so shouldn't put too much into it. So here is a series of weekly average inverted sections from a few years, where we have selected just one of the weeks per month. So we step 1 month ahead for each data set here, or each inverted section. So essentially what we can see, I suppose, is that we have less resistive conditions during the summer and the early autumn, and more resistive in the winter and early spring. And we have some areas here where we have more variation. One thing that we should try to do also with this, we are measuring not only with multiple gradient, but also with some sort of dipole, larger transmitting circuit and smaller receiver circuit. And we haven't joined those data sets and inverted it together. I think we should do that and also have an extended model version. We've had limited resources to look at this. So again, here are some cells extracted from the inverted model, so we can follow the variation in individual cells over the years here. And so some, at the same level. So here is an example where we have higher resistivity and somewhat less variation. This is more variation, I suppose, and this one is quite large variation behavior. So this is actually done on commission from the dam owner, and my colleague Pontus is doing this as part of the monitoring of the dam, where they are looking at other things also. So this is actually in commercial operation and used as part of the condition assessment of the dam. Then, just to show you another site, this is a site where we were monitoring for a few years, but it stopped several years ago because the dam owner thought that we don't see any trouble, so why should we pay for this, more or less. But this is a site where there's a huge variation in water level over the year, so that, to some extent, of course, can complicate the evaluation. And in this case, there are electrodes installed along this part and along that part of the dam. And I will show some results from that part. So we had the instrument sitting somewhere here, and then cable layouts here. And we were also measuring the water. I forgot to say that, but we were measuring the water resistivity and temperature in the pipe from this building, and we're doing it in similar ways for the other dams. And in this case, the design is somewhat different. We have a sort of leaning core, but it will act in the same way electrically. Anyway. So here we've also extracted the time series in the same way, and this is the relative variation, where we have parts in the below the foundation level. This is the foundation level. This is the rock level. So this is partly founded on soil. Here we have little temporal variation, and here we have a lot more. And so this time series here comes from that change, whereas the other ones are less, or these ones. But here we have tried to fit a model with a temperature induced resistivity variation to the time variation here, and through that being able to estimate a flow. And so the total flow here is estimated to 1 liter per second. This was published in the Geophysics of Physics some years ago. And then just finally a small example here from Kropstadfors. This was just a very short experiment. This is actually an embankment dam which has been disguised as a parking lot here, over here. And there are problems with water leaking into this building and leaking out on the downstream side here, which triggered the investigation. So after the garage owner who had taken over this building, which was formerly a power plant, had moved some cars, we could drill through the asphalt and install electrodes temporarily. And then we used this workshop as a temporary space for our instrument, and they kept their reservoir level at the fixed level first, and then they rise with a step. And so we took a number of measurements before and during this raise in water level. And so this is the resistivity, inverted resistivity section, and then this is the water level at the start of the experiment. And here they increase the level of the water, and then we can see that we get decreasing resistivity very much around that level, where in between where the different water levels were. I'll step back here. So I believe what we see here is follows the change quite nicely. We could actually imagine also that we have somewhat falling groundwater level into the structure. This, I believe, is 3D effects because we are not so far from the water, so we are partly looking into the water. This could be drying out. It had been raining a lot before this experiment, but the surface here was covered by asphalt, but here it was not. So this is probably drying out after the rain. And these are just some slides. You can see the signs of internal erosion here, settlements. And you see features like this, it was leaking out here. And there were actually cracks in the building, so probably our conclusion was that a lot of the geraltrunas problem came from direct leakage into the building through cracks. The situation was clearly not quite satisfactory. So, to sum up here, good electrode installations are really essential for data quality. We've seen that very clearly. And on the Swedish downs, the possible location for electrode installation is often limited to the crest, the downstream toe, and maybe the upstream side, but in many cases we cannot do anything on the downstream slope. We should expect to get severe 3D effects in 2D data. When we evaluate this through the repeated measurements, we focus on long-term changes, which could mean erosion and washout of fines. Large variations could be related to high seepage, and increasing variations could be increasing seepage. Lack of relevant reference data is a problem for verification and full interpretation of this monitoring data. And it's very clear that further development is needed for streamlined routine application, especially when it comes to data handling and interpretation. So I believe we have a need for further research and development on the data handling, processing, immersion, and archiving of the data. Also 3D acquisition approaches for 3D, 4D immersion of these time series. We also need to look into better ways of accounting for the 3D geometry when we invert the 2D data. We are measuring IP data. There are ways of improving the quality of that for sure that we have been working on lately in other projects, but also processing, inversion, and interpretation in a monitoring setup needs a lot of work. And then something which is very interesting in a context like this would be to look at coupled modeling inversion for integrated interpretation of the groundwater flow, including ion transport, etc., and temperature, and the geophysical signatures in data. So, thanks for your attention. I took a little bit extra time, but I will not do any other short presentation on the other hand.
It's two in one. So any questions, please?
Some of your early figures, you showed these ratio images, but wasn't there clear the units? saw some variation, but I didn't understand what
zero. Yeah, so, so it's unitless, it's sort of relative variation. So it's a variation divided by the mean or median of the period.
So it could be, I mean, one was not kind of clear whether it was a kind of increase or decrease, if that's, so you don't care about this, you care about the percentage.
Yeah, we know that we have a cyclic variation, so in this application because of the seasonal variation, so this relative variation or variation coefficient just cares about how large is the total variation, because it could be going up and down through the years. And it's, yeah, the variation divided by the average or median.
So, do you see any effect you think in like your electrode, like in corrosion or like, I mean, I know it's stainless steel, but like either electro effect or contact effect or anything in the mineralization as you're injecting?
We haven't. Look close enough, I suppose. We've not been measuring the contact resistance in a systematic way, which would have been a good thing to do, of course, but that instrument that we built is not really so suited for that because of the limited input range. With the some later work, we've been using a standard terameter for measurement, and that can measure directly on the current electrodes while transmitting full load. But we cannot do it with these instruments. But it would be relevant to do it. We haven't really seen any signs of degradation here, the data. But we've been very careful with the material. I mean, we're using stainless steel plates, which are joined to stainless steel wires. That are coated with polyurethane, and then we have a watertight seal to the pins that they are take out from the electrode cable. So we have electrode cable with pig tape tank out, and then we join them together and make sure that we get a watertight seal, because if we would have different metals exposed to the moisture here, it would mean corrosion for sure.
Just in addition, could we, even if you didn't measure the contact resistance, could you in a way indirectly understand whether there was a degrading effect by just seeing the current that systematically should be less and less?
Yeah, I suppose if we took time to analyze, we have a lot of data, so we just need someone to look at it. We are also measuring reciprocals, and so we there's all the data is there, I suppose, but we haven't had time to look at it.
So any more questions?
Yeah. Have you ever tried joint inversion temperature and resistivity?
Not really joint inversion. There's been some sort of more simplistic evaluation approaches, like the one I showed an example of here, with trying to estimate the flow by fitting function, but not real inversion like that. That's something that would be really interesting to look at also.
You mentioned the lack of reference data, and I imagine in a dam situation you don't have any options for kind of intrusive investigation. Have you thought about using any other geophysical techniques? I'm thinking seismic survey, SW, that kind of thing, to look at any degradation in geomechanical properties over time?
That's something that would also be interesting, and my colleagues at Hydro Research have been trying to get funding for doing some experiments with seismics and using actually optical fibers for measuring sensors. Because they are working a lot with optic fibers for temperature measurements, and nowadays you can also do seismic measurements with optic fibers, which is amazing, in my opinion. But So I could mention that temperature monitoring with optic fibers is becoming the standard technique in Sweden now. I'm not sure how many dams they have installations on. I think it's close to 100 dams now. And then some of them they have permanent installations with instruments, but in most cases they go there every now and then and measure, look at the seasonal variation. But it's usually only possible to install along the dam, so and not inside the dam, because the dam owner don't want to drill in the dam, because that would be a potential way of breaking the dam. And this is also why it's difficult to get reference data. In many cases they have installed various sensors in the dams when they were constructed, but that was maybe 50 years ago and these sensors are no longer functional.
What are the issues around 3D data acquisition? You mentioned you probably can't install your lines everywhere across the dam, I'm guessing, because of access problems or safety problems?
Like in this case, we have installations in the upper part of the crest, and we also installed electrodes at the dam top. But this is just
off limits.
Big stone blocks, this is the old installation. Now they put new, really solid blocks of stone here on top of the slope, and it's just not possible to get any electrode contact. Of course, on the upstream side, you could have several parallel layouts if you like.
Because you showed that some of your 2D models clearly are affected by 3D geometry.
Yeah.
So, could you not, even with, say, on the dams where you have two or three parallel lines, could you not even sort of fit those against? Because the 3D geometry is well known, I guess, off the dam, as you showed.
Yeah.
Maybe you could do that. You could fit the 2D lines you have got against the 3D model. Maybe that could improve.
Yeah, I would think that could be done. Also, given that you have time and resources for the details.
That answers the question.
Yeah. But this is something that, I have approached the energy research council in Sweden this year and suggested a pilot project on looking at this data. And also, we have electrodes installed on yet another dam where we have electrodes along the crest and along the bottom, at the bottom of the dam. So three electrode lines. It was a little dam that was built where we got the possibility, and there's also optic fibers, but we have only measured once on it and we didn't get further funding, but we hope to get that. But they said that, oh, thank you, we have looked at this, but we would like you to make a literature study of state of the art first. Okay. Have to do that first then, and then see.
Yes.
But I think there's a lot of potential in this.
Well, thank you very much for that.
Yeah, and there's a poster showing just a little bit.
So we have now three